Everyone, stand by, and thank you for your expertise on this. I want to bring in now Wajahat Ali. He's a creative director of Affinis Labs, who is a contributor to the New York Times. CNN political analyst David Gergen is with us. CNN political commentator Carl Bernstein. He joins us by phone, and also Paige Pate. I'm so glad to have all of you on this evening. So, Paige, talk to us constitutionally. What exactly is happening here? Is this? Are we in a constitutional crisis?
I don't think we're there yet, Don. I mean, obviously, Sally Yates decided to step aside because she had both legal and moral problems trying to defend this executive order in court. But the Trump administration moved quickly. They went ahead and appointed someone else to serve in that capacity as acting attorney general. But I think we're seeing a pattern here that really is problematic. It seems that they have some impatience in the White House that they cannot wait until they have their people confirmed and approved and into the job before they start making major policy changes that may very well have constitutional or legal problems. You needed an attorney general, some senior folks in the Justice Department to review this thing before it was signed and before it was implemented. And I think Sally Yates' primary problem was that it wasn't done that way, and nobody talked to us about it, and so you can't now ask us just to step in and defend this thing when we don't believe in it.
David Gergen, that's a lot of big moves in one night. Who's calling the shots at the White House?
Well, it's hard to tell, isn't it? Obviously, Donald Trump's got the final say, but it does sound from all reports that Mr. Bannon, Steve Bannon, has expanding influence in the White House, not only over domestic policy. You know, he was a co-author, reportedly, of the president's inaugural address. It was his dark vision that animated that address, but also his. It appears that he was the guiding force in this executive order, and in getting it out the door the way it was done. I think Priebus has to accept some responsibility as chief of staff for the way this was done too. But I want to go back to one thing, Don. I think that the president may have some additional consequences. I think there may be trouble brewing about the way the White House is doing these. Taking these important steps without conferring with his full national security team. It's shocking to me that General Mattis was not brought into this, that the Homeland Security General Kelly was not brought into this at the time, and that State Department Mr. Tillerson was not brought into this. But I would in particular point to General Mattis now. This is about the second or third time the reports have been out that he's been incensed that things are happening without being checked with him before they do it. And I have a sense, my reading would be that when they put out the word that they were going to move on torture, they're going to move affirmatively on reinstating torture, and the next day President Trump said, I think I'll defer to General Mattis on this. My bet is that Mattis put his job on the line. So you want to? I'm out of here if you guys keep doing this. And I'm particularly opposed to this. Yeah. So I think these guys have some leverage in the cabinet. But what's stunning to me is that the White House has done this now more than once to people like Mattis, that they act, that Bannon acts, they don't check it out. And I think.
But we saw this, David. We saw this during the campaign. He would say something and do something, and then you know, his surrogates would have to come out afterwards and clean it up. And many times they found out about it as they were sitting here on the set about to go on and talk about it in the news. But I want you to stand by, David. And
that's a very good point, Don.
I want you to stand by as well. And lots of moving parts here. We have some more developing news. I need to get back to Evan Perez, our justice reporter here. Evan, what do you have for us?
Well, Don, one of the big questions was tonight whether Dana Bente, the U.S. attorney for the Eastern District of Virginia, who just took over as acting attorney general, he was sworn in at 9 p.m., whether he has the full authorities of the acting attorney general. I'm told that by people who have been looking at this tonight that he does. He is a Senate-confirmed U.S. attorney. He was confirmed by the Senate in 2015. And by the way, he served in the Justice Department for about 29 years. He's been around for a long time. And because he is a Senate-confirmed U.S. attorney and now acting attorney general, he has all the authorities, including the ability to sign surveillance warrants, which is a big part of the job. These are warrants that come across the desk of the attorney general every day in order for the NSA, for the FBI, to be able to do some of the most important national security jobs that they do. And he has the authority to sign off on those. That's something that was going to be a big issue for the Trump White House. if they couldn't find someone to fill these shoes since they were going to fire Sally Yates. That's what we're told. That's the ruling from the lawyers who've been looking at this all evening, that he does have the full authority of the acting attorney general. Meanwhile, we wait for Jeff Sessions to come in.
Yeah, and that could take longer now, considering what's happened. Democrats will probably have a lot more questions for him. Wajahat, I want to get to you now because, you know, you're fired. Works really well for Donald Trump on television. The question is, will it work in the White House? I've been watching you all weekend. This started as, you know, with this refugee ban, which you see as a Muslim ban. It then snowballed now to a crisis of leadership. What do you make of what's going on and all of the developments that have happened since this weekend?
Well, President Bannon, President Trump's Muslim ban, is that a Muslim ban? And the reason we know that is Rudy Giuliani, probably because he's getting really old, blurted his mouth and said that President Trump, Bannon's poodle came to him and said, I want to do the Muslim ban, find me the legal way to do it. President Trump, throughout his entire campaign, said the following, that he would do a temporary or permanent ban of Muslims. That he said openly, Islam hates us, not radical Islam, Don, Islam hates us. He said he's open to a Muslim registry. He said he wants to do an extreme vetting of Muslims. So yes, call this what it is. It's a Muslim ban. Anyone who says anything else, it's an alternative fact, which is doublespeak for a lie. I'm an American Muslim born and raised in this country, and my wife, Sarah, is from Okeechobee, Florida, right? She was born there in Okeechobee, Florida, and literally there were no other minorities, and so for about 20 years, people thought she was Latino, even though she's South Asian. She told me 3 days ago for the first time, and this is a very sobering point, she says, for the first time in my life, I'm worried about the safety of our two American Muslim kids in this country. It broke my heart. I have these two babies, Ibrahim, 2.5 years old, a wild Sufi, rambunctious and crazy, and my warrior princess Nuseba, who's 6 months old. Both of them are adorable and cute and look just like Sarah. Thank God they don't look like me. And it broke my heart. But at the same time, there's a saying of the Prophet Muhammad, and it's a beautiful saying. It says, even if the day of judgment is around the corner, plant a seed. And it may look like one of the four horsemen of the apocalypse is President Trump, but plant a seed. My faith commands me to be hopeful, not to give in to despondency, cynicism, and hate. And you know what I'm going to tell my kids, Don, and this is important. I told my son right before I left, I don't think he understood me, he's 2.5. I said, you're going to resist. This America belongs to you, and I want you to succeed, and I want you to thrive. Mm-hmm. There are going to be haters who are going to try to bring you down, but you're going to outwork them, outsmart them, outdebate them, outthink them, outtweet them. You're going to out-hustle them, you're going to out-dream them, out-hope them, and inshallah, you will forgive them. The beautiful thing about President Bannon is the following. He has awakened a multicultural coalition of the willing. Slumbering giants, kings, and queens have woken up and taken to the streets. Men of different colors, ethnicities, national origins, religions are out there saying that we want to defend America, and we're coming for the crown, Steve Bannon. And we're going to take it and we're going
to
win.
And I've got to get to the break. Thank you very much, gentlemen. I appreciate it. Our breaking news coverage continues right after this.